The death toll from the magnitude 5.6 quake that rocked Indonesia's Java Island Monday rises to over 160. The shallow afternoon quake toppled buildings and triggered landslides on the island. Rescuers worked into the night looking for survivors, with about 24 people still believed to be missing. The tremor was felt in the capital, Jakarta, a three-hour drive away, but there were no reports of casualties or major damage there. According to authorities, over 60 aftershocks have been reported. They warn residents to stay on alert in case of rain, which could trigger more landslides.
Former Filipino decathlete David Bunivalz is sentenced to more than 17 years in prison by a California court after scamming billions of dollars from cannabis industry investors. Let's get more details from our North America correspondent, Steve Angelis. Steve, go ahead. What more can you tell us?
Yes, Mike. David Bunivalz has been sentenced to 210 months or 17 and a half years of prison and has also been ordered to pay some $35 million in restitution to the alleged victims of his Ponzi scheme. The former Philippine athlete turned TV personality had been in custody since April of this year. Last July, he pled guilty to one count of securities fraud and one count of wire fraud. Under the scheme going back to as early as 2010, Bunivalz created several business entities that supposedly operated in the cannabis industry. The scheme had raised some $45 million, which prosecutors say funded his lavish lifestyle instead of the businesses. While Bunivalz declined to make statements in court, his lawyer requested that he be given an 87-month sentence, citing that the 53-year-old was diagnosed with advanced heart failure and had not seen a cardiologist since his arrest 8 months ago. More than a dozen victims were present in court, and six spoke during the sentencing hearing. Throughout each testimony, he did not look at or acknowledge any of the victims as they described their personal and business relationships with him. In some cases, victims would use their own companies and life savings to fund their investments. The victims say he used their personal relationships and false documents to convince them to invest. After the hearing, the victims tell us that they were hoping for the maximum penalty, but they will accept the judge's ruling. Mike?
Steve, do we know how many victims were actually involved in this case? And to what extent was the scale of the fraud that Mr. Bunivalz actually inflicted on these investors?
As far as the number of victims, I've seen different releases from different agencies. Some say more than five. Of course, any number six and up is more than five. Some said there's at least 40. The victims themselves told me that they're estimating there's at least 100 of them. And it's while a majority were from the Southern California area, which he was based out of, there was actually one victim that flew in from Canada to testify. So especially with the cannabis industry, a lot of people were looking at California that legalized the recreational use a few years ago. So they had taken that opportunity to meet with him. He actually met some of the victims in different places. One victim says they met in China some years back. So it was quite widespread. And yeah, we could be looking at about 100 victims out there.
All right. We will stand by for more updates from you, Steve. Thank you for that update.
Suspect in the shooting rampage at a U.S. LGBTQ nightclub facing murder and potential hate crime charges. Police have released the identity of the 22-year-old suspect in Saturday night's attack that left five people dead and up to 30 people injured, but have not yet indulged a motive. For the mayor of Colorado Springs, the shooting had the trapping of a hate crime. A state judge has sealed court records related to the arrest until prosecutors finish the investigation. The attack was the deadliest on the LGBTQ community in the United States since a mass shooting at a nightclub in Orlando, Florida in 2016 that claimed 49 lives.